Auburn University has its piercing eyes on a third straight SEC crown. But Coach Pat Dye believes his program is capable of even larger prey. Reggie Slack is a poised quarterback and the nation's leading passer. The cry of War Eagle has been heard throughout the South as Auburn has soared to victory twice, and no one has penetrated the defense that today hopes to stomp on another opponent. Volunteers of Tennessee have a favorite son in Coach Johnny Majors. A year ago, he was on the hot seat after six opening losses. But now the Vols have racked up eight straight wins with a pair of reckless running backs who have led the gallant fight back to national prominence. Today, it's an SEC showdown. Auburn and Tennessee coming up next on CBS. For CFA action, Southeastern Conference style. The folks from the state of Tennessee have filtered all the way across this soggy state. Over 90,000 will be on hand today at Mammoth Neyland Stadium to see their Volunteers challenge the two-time defending SEC champions. It's fourth-ranked Auburn against 12th-ranked Tennessee. Coming up next. Been raining all week here in Tennessee, but it certainly hasn't dampened the spirits of the Volunteer faithful. Good afternoon, everybody, and welcome to Knoxville. I'm Jim Nance. There's a lot of hope here in Tennessee because this team, the Volunteers, have been revived this season and at the start of last year. This is a team that went out to the West Coast and knocked off UCLA convincingly. But today they face a challenge from an Auburn squad that has won the SEC back-to-back years. Auburn is a team that's really looking at a national scope. They've been close to a national championship. They feel maybe this is another year. Remember one thing. The last time Auburn was number one, it came to Knoxville, and the Volunteers beat them 38-20. So it's probably going to be rain and drizzle throughout the day, but it's going to be a war here in the Southeastern Conference. Right now, let's get an update from the studio in New York and our man there, of course, Greg Gumbel. Greg? Back to a sea of orange, Neyland Stadium on the campus of the University of Tennessee. And on the field, the pride of the Southland, marching band. For more on today's game, let me bring in my colleague in the booth, currently stationed down on the field, Pat Hayden. Good afternoon to you, Pat.
All right, Jimmy, thank you very much. Ever since the days of General Bob Nealon, for whom this stadium is named, Southeastern Conference football has been characterized by great defense. Auburn knows that. Last year, they led the country in scoring defense. They do again this year. Pat Dye thinks this team has not been tested yet. But, you know, I talked to him yesterday, and he thinks this team will be emotionally ready to play today.
Every team has a different personality. And I don't know what this team's personality is yet. I don't think they're scared, but there hadn't been two words spoken since we got on the bus at Auburn.
Now, this defense is led by two senior linebackers, Quentin Riggins and Craig Ogletree. They told me yesterday they think this defense has a chance to be as good as last year. Now, they have some concerns about the Tennessee offense. First, their offensive line. I think it's one of the best in the Southeastern Conference. But they are most concerned about the Cobb-Webb rushing attack of the Tennessee Volunteers. They have two running backs, Reggie Cobb and Chuck Webb, who share the position of tailback. These guys have the ability to go the distance, but get to two tough yards when you really need it. Now, Jim, both teams want to win this game by rushing the football, but with the weather like this, I very much think it's going to be a matter of turnovers and special teams. And Jim, save some room up there. Smokey and I are going to come up getting dry.
All right, Pat, we got a headset for you both. I tell you what, it's interesting how some folks get here to Neyland Stadium for the game. In fact, about 1,000 fans come in on 300 vessels up the Tennessee River, which is adjacent here to the stadium. Fascinating way to come to a college football game. But you know what? Our John Dockery this morning found an even more interesting way to get here.
You know, Jim, boats aren't the only way to get to the game. Dr. Joe Beals has himself a 1960 Cadillac hearse called the Volmobile.
It
put a horn on that plays the UT fight song down the field. Let me play that for you here. Once we had that on the strip, and after we won the SEC 3 or 4 years ago, and the battery was totally dead, and there was no problem. All the students came out, and they pushed us practically all the way home.
Well, John Madden and his cruiser certainly have nothing on Joe Beals and the Volmobile.
See, they were looking for a Cadillac with Tennessee plates.
Well, he made it here safely, even though they were driving down the wrong lane, the left side of the road. But here come the Auburn Tigers, ranked number 4 in the country. This team, last time it was here, 1987, a 20-20 tie. And Pat Dye's team, ranked number 1 in 1985, lost that day here in 85 to the Volunteers. Feeling it is to bust out onto this field with 90,000 plus just waiting for you. And here come the Tennessee Volunteers, winners of 8 consecutive games. SEC opener for both Auburn and Tennessee, the 41st meeting for these two. They're ready to battle in Knoxville, Tennessee.
CBS Sports presents college football live from Neyland Stadium in Knoxville, Tennessee. It's the Auburn Tigers versus the Tennessee Volunteers. Today's CFA game is sponsored by Toyota. Whatever car or truck you choose, you'll love the quality. Who could ask for anything more? Visa, accepted at nearly 7 million places worldwide. Visa is everywhere you want to be. And by Coors Light, pure brewed in the Rockies, the Silver Bullet won't slow you down. It's the right beer now.
Well, the weather today, all rain. That was the case yesterday, has been throughout the day today. We'll stay that way throughout the weekend, in fact, here in Tennessee, but right now, let's go back down to John Dockery. John, you made it safely, huh, from the Volmobile.
Yes, there were no fatalities in that hearse. But, Jim, you mentioned the weather. It's been raining for 2 days solid. The squeegees have been out, but the field is very damp. It is slippery. I suspect it's certainly playable. The wind isn't that much of a factor. It's a light rain, but it will have an effect on the game, as Pat Hayden say. I think in the kicking game, I think you'll see both teams try to run the ball early. Now back to you, Pat. Jim.
All right, Doc. The Volunteers won the toss and deferred. So Greg Burke will kick. Shane Wasden of Auburn standing at the 4-yard line. We are underway at Tennessee. Ball is free. And a knee, was it down?
I thought it was. The
Pat, I thought the knee was down at the 5. James Joseph has the football at the 13-yard line.
Referee Dick Burleson was right there. Again, you're going to, we talked about the weather already. John Dockery just mentioned that it's a light rain coming down. Right off high on his chest, he wasn't using his hands, and I thought his knee was down. The left knee was down when he picked that ball up.
Auburn Tigers, first and 10 from their own 13. They start with Danley in the backfield. They'll alternate tailbacks, and Danley scoots his way to the 20 and a pickup of 7. Let's meet some of these Auburn Tigers. Reggie Slack is the quarterback, leads the nation right now in passing efficiency. Alex Strong, the fullback. Danley on the first carry for 7. The wide receivers, the speedster, Alexander Wright and Greg Taylor. Second down and 3 for Auburn. Give to Strong. He has the first down, and he's to the 30-yard line. A 10-yard pickup for the fullback, Alex Strong. The Tennessee front seven. Let's meet them. Mark Moore and Martin Williams. 5'11", 270, Martin Williams. A couple of great ends, Marion Hobby and Tracy Hayward. Shazan Bradley, a sophomore, is the middle linebacker, and he is flanked by Ernest Fields and a very active Darrell Hardy. First and 10 for Auburn from the 30. Danley lining up as the tailback out of the eye. Danley with the carry. He's met in the backfield. Met by Marion Hobby.
Marion Hobby is a guy that's been run away from in the Volunteers' first three ball games. No one has run to his side. They have that much respect for him. Grew up not far from Auburn, was not recruited by Auburn, but he was looking forward to playing Auburn for his very last time. He is a senior. Great rushing plays, chasing plays back from the backside.
Boy, Notre Dame just piling it on Purdue today. That was a loss of four, so it's second and 14 for the Tigers. Alex Strong. Again, it's Hobby. Hobby and Shazan Bradley.
Well, you can see why people are running away from Marion Hobby. He's got tremendous hand and arm strength. He just keeps people away from his body. He moved from defensive tackle to defensive end. They line him up wide, and he gets up ahead of steam, and he's going to cause some contact and make some big plays.
Back-to-back tackles for loss. That was a loss of a yard on that. Marion Hobby from Irondale, Alabama. They call him the Iron Man. Third and 15. Hobby chasing after him. Danley cannot hold on. Marion Hobby was quickly in the backfield. Slack got the pass away, but Stacy Danley could not hold on. So Chris Dickinson will punt for the Auburn Tigers. Thomas Woods will return for the Volunteers. Dickinson, a low driving kick. Backs Woods to the 31-yard line, right up the middle to the 43. 12-yard return to Minko Anderson on the tackle. Sterling Hinton out of Passaic, New Jersey, quarterbacks the Volunteers. Roland Poles and Reggie Cobb in the backfield. The wingback is Anthony Morgan. He has great speed. And the man on the return, Thomas Woods, lines up as a split end. Good field position for the Volunteers on their first possession. The give is to Poles, straight ahead for 3 yards. Runs into David Rocker. The rest of the Auburn line. Nose tackle is Richard Shea, sophomore from Birmingham. There's David Rocker, younger brother of Tracy, last year's Outland and Lombardi Award winner, along with John Wilson. Linebackers, Crawford and Riggins, Ogletree and Larry Young. We'll hear a lot from Ogletree and Riggins today. Second and seven. Reggie Cobb. First down, Tennessee.
Now, Richie Cobb has a great way of making guys miss at the very last moment. Darrell Crawford, the inside linebacker for Auburn, really had a shot at it. But watch the block at the center. John Fisher, number 51, right there in the middle of the screen. He blocks the nose tackle out. Big hole there as Eric Still, number 79, comes around and keys the block, but ran right through the tackle of Darrell Crawford. He can make his moves right at the last moment.
The ball rests at the Auburn 46-yard line. First and 10. The pitch to Cobb for 2 yards. Craig Ogletree and David Rocker combine on the Auburn tackle. The Tennessee line, John Fisher, sophomore center, flanked by the guards, Mislinski and Eric Still, all-SEC performer. The tackles, Charles McCray and Antone Davis. The tight end, Vaughn Reeves, sophomore from right here in Knoxville. Second down and 8. Hinton Throwing for the first time for the tight end, Mark Adams, incomplete. Meet the Auburn secondary now. The corners, Eric Ramsey, Corey Barlow, a sophomore, young secondary, two sophomores, two juniors. Frankie Stankunas and John Wiley are the safeties.
This Auburn defense, we talked at the beginning of the show, but Pat Dye believes in playing a lot of guys. They have eight defensive linemen. They'll rotate in that defensive front.
Greg Amsler is in the backfield for the Volunteers on third and eight. Hinton gets away. Not from Richard Shea. Yes, gets away from Shea, but not this time. Quentin Riggins finishes him off.
Well, there's no in the grass rule in college football, obviously, and that gives Sterling Hinton a chance to fight through the nose tackle, Richard Shea. The one thing about this Auburn defense, they play great team defense. You're going to see a lot of white jerseys around the ball today.
Riggins drops him for a 16-yard loss. Kent Eltmore will punt. He was third in the nation last year and the best in the SEC. Wasden standing at the 18-yard line. Fields the low snap. Wasden from the 20 mishandles that one. Remember, he bobbled the opening kick, but he holds on. Auburn has it from its own 19-yard line. So Auburn and Tennessee both pick up a first down. That's all. Then they punt away. We're in the first quarter from Knoxville. And the Auburn Tigers have won back-to-back Southeastern Conference championships, playing last year in the Sugar Bowl, falling there to Florida State. Let's meet the Tiger offensive line. John Hudson is at center. The guards, Ed King, the much talked about Ed King, only a sophomore, and Mark Rose. And the tackles, Bob Meeks, Rob Selby, who's heralded as the strongest player in Auburn history. Pat Autry, a senior, former walk-on, is the tight end for the Tigers. Strong, and now James Joseph in the backfield. Joseph, tailback out of the eye. Play action fake, slack, rolling left and looking. Pass to Overton. Is it? Yes. Foot was down at the 36-yard line. A gain of 16.
Well, that's a nice throw in this kind of weather. And I was talking to Reggie Swack and Pat Sullivan, his quarterback, before the game, and they said this weather is not going to affect their play calling. They're going to come out and throw the football. He's got huge hands, gets his hips turned. A lot of guys, when they're throwing the ball to the left, don't get the hips turned, but he threw that ball on time, so it was the easy catch by Overton and got the foot in.
First and 10 from the 35. James Joseph's first carry.
Oof, wow.
Barrels his way to the 42-yard line. The secondary for Tennessee, Preston Warren. He's a good one. And Kelly Days at the corners. Safeties, Mark Fletcher, Jason Julian. Second down and three after the 7-yard gain from James Joseph. The last time the Tigers played here, on the first play of the game, Joseph broke his kneecap and still played the rest of the game. He's number 10, lined up in the eye, the tailback. Pedro Carey in motion. Busted play, flags fly.
Well, you're talking about James Joseph and kneecap. I think it's one of the most painful things that you can possibly go through, a fractured kneecap, and yet he fought through it, played the entire game, and it really wasn't until Wednesday of the next week.
Dead ball foul. Offside defense.
But between James Joseph and Stacy Danley, two guys who share that tailback position, they think they have what they need to win in the Southeastern Conference, and that's a very strong rushing attack. And one of the best offensive lines in the SEC as well.
People always talk about Auburn's defense, which is superb. It's been the best in the nation. Was last year. But this Auburn offense has led the SEC in offense four of the last 5 years. First and five, Joseph. Actually, that was first and 10, and Joseph gets near midfield. Darrell Hardy on the tackle.
You know, before the game, Reggie Slack has a little routine that he goes to. He gets here 2 hours before the game. He goes in and gets a program. Then he comes out with Pat Sullivan, his quarterback coach, the former Heisman Trophy winner. They talk about the game plan. He wishes him luck, and then Reggie goes into the locker room just to think about the game.
Pat Sullivan says, I wouldn't trade Reggie Slack for any quarterback in America. Second down and eight. Joseph. Good speed, doesn't he? Wet playing surface. Gets to the 44-yard line. Cut under by Tracy Hayward.
You know, it's been amazing here in their two drives. Auburn first started to try to run right, but Marion Hobby said, no thanks, you better go the other way. Then they've come out in this drive, and they've had a lot more success when they've run to their left side.
Third down and one. Auburn's first penetration into Tennessee territory. Fullback strong near the first down. Alex Strong, a senior from Macon, Georgia, fifth year man. He had to sit out in 1986, broke his leg. Did number 40, Alex Strong. At the measure here for the first down.
Now, even if they don't make it, I think Pat Dye has already made his decision. He has sent Greg Taylor in with a play.
Well, they're not even going to measure Pat. They're going to say he's about a foot short. Pat Dye has taken the Tigers to seven straight bowls, including five New Year's Day bowls.
And he's got two tight ends into the game. Now he's worried about the clock. He's worried about them breaking the huddle. Worry about the 25-second clock, which is now down to 8 seconds.
Down clock is at 3 seconds. I'm not sure Reggie Slack's aware, but he is. He calls the timeout just in time.
That's a poor use of a timeout. They should have had the play called and snapped before they had to use a timeout.
So a timeout in Auburn facing fourth and a foot. Orange everywhere at Neyland Stadium. And during the timeout, Pat Dye changed his mind. He's brought out his punting team, Pat.
Yeah, again, although they're in a formation where they can actually snap it to their short man, but it looks like he's going to punt and play defense, and that's the kind of confidence that he does have in this Auburn front eight.
John Wiley is the short man, the up back for Auburn. We'll watch him. Thomas Woods, the return man for Tennessee. Dickinson angling the kick. Where did it go out of bounds? And the march ends at the 19-yard line. Tennessee's ball from there. Right now, let's take it back down to John Dockery.
You know, Jim Nance, seldom has Auburn had to deal with wet artificial turf. Only four times in the last 9 years have they played on wet synthetic surface. On the other side of the ball, Tennessee played seven of their 11 games last year, winning four at the end of the season. And interesting, earlier this week, Johnny Majors, on a day much like today, brought his team here to practice on the wet field just in case. The man may be a prophet. Back to you, Jim.
Yeah, wise move. Reggie Cobb on first down to the 22-yard line. We got an update. Let's send you back to New York with Greg Gumbel. Greg.
Jim, in the American League East playoff, or at least the series to determine who will be the winner, George Bell's RBI single in the bottom of the first inning has given the Blue Jays the lead. It came off of Dave Johnson, the starter for the Orioles today, replacing Pete Harnisch, the scheduled starter. He stepped on a nail last night after last night's game. Let's go back to Knoxville.
All right, Greg, we'll keep everyone posted on that. Here goes Reggie Cobb, first down for Tennessee. To the 32-yard line, stopped by John Wiley after a 9-yard gain for Reggie Cobb.
Now, Reggie Cobb was telling us this week, he says, I run as much with my eyes as I do with my feet. Everything was stacked up inside. It was supposed to be an inside play. Then he bounces it to the outside. He gets a nice block by number one, Vince Moore, and spinning and churning for the first down. But he said, my feet follow my eyes.
Amsler, the fullback, Cobb, the tailback on first and 10. Greg Amsler, junior from Chatham, New Jersey, to the 37-yard line.
Well, Greg Amsler is a guy who can give you a big play out of the fullback position. He's a lot better runner than most fullbacks you're going to see. They don't just send him in the game for a 2-yard plunge. He has the ability to give you 20, 30 yards right now.
Pat, Johnny Majors has brought in the freshman, Chuck Webb, as the tailback for the first time. Webb's first carry. bulldozes his way to the 44-yard line. Lamar Rogers met him at the 44-yard line. Chuck Webb, what do you think of him, Beth?
Well, Johnny Majors, and I see one tape from him, he's got explosive speed, and Johnny Majors is really excited about the future of Chuck Webb. What he has is the ability to go 90 yards right now, and he's still strong enough to break through some tackles. He can run sideways as fast as he can straight ahead.
Ran through UCLA for over 130 yards and two touchdowns to Chuck Webb, who runs again. This time, run out to the 49-yard line. Quentin Riggins drops him there.
We really have two good tandems of backs. You see, Auburn's going to use Daly and Joseph, while Tennessee uses Cobb and Webb. And I think this is a great deal in this conference, because in the Southeastern Conference, you're going to have a lot of close ball games won in the fourth quarter, the last 4 minutes of the fourth quarter, and you need a fresh running back.
Second down and four. Webb, third straight carry. Another first down for the Volunteers. Greg Ogletree on the Auburn tackle. Three carries, 19 yards for Chuck Webb. First down, Tennessee at the Auburn 45.
Boy, and a nice block by the tight end, Vaughn Reeves. But what you're going to see here of Webb, the way he picks his way through the hole, he's very patient. He doesn't rush things. A lot of running backs will see a hole and they just slam right through it. But he waited and he waited and waited to the last moment and then made his cut.
Webb again. Elton Billingsley hit him first. Short gain on the play. Darrell Crawford finished him off.
You know, I asked Johnny Majors how they got a guy from Toledo, Ohio here, because he was being recruited by all the Big Ten schools and such. But Johnny went down there to visit him, as he is one official visit, and really sold him, I think, on Tennessee. The tradition of the I backs they've had here, they're going to run the I formation, and he was going to get a chance to carry the ball an awful lot.
Also, I'm sure it didn't hurt that he could say he coached Tony Dorsett in college, to Johnny Majors. Now this is Reggie Cobb. Boy, this team is moving it now on this Auburn defense.
I'll tell you, on this drive, Jim, I am very surprised how well Tennessee is running the football. And give their offensive line some credit. Very few people run the ball as well as Tennessee is right now against this defense. Watch the right guard here, Eric Still. He is the All-American candidate. As he blocks down, the left guard, left tackle pull around, and there is a huge hole the size of New Hampshire right there that Reggie Cobb could run through.
Well, Cobb is their primary tailback, and he picks up the first down.
You know, this is something Pat Dye said. He was uncertain how good this defense was. And Wayne Hall, their defensive coordinator, says, we're going to find out a lot about our defense after today's game.
Cobb gets a block from Cleveland. Out of bounds at the 16-yard line. Good block to help free him by Terrence Cleveland, number four.
And the fullback, Bowles, number 42. But Dre, the wide receiver block, as you mentioned, number four, can make a 3 or 4 yard gain into a much larger gain, and that's what the block by Cleveland did.
First down from the 16. Webb back in. Webb to the 15, just a 1 yard pickup. Rocker and Riggins on the tackle for Auburn.
You know, Auburn had come in, as you can see, 28 yards rushing. But we've said a couple times, Wayne Hall, their defensive coordinator, said we really have not been tested yet. They beat up on Pacific and handled Southern Mississippi, but they knew they were in for a test today.
11th play of the drive, all on the ground. Second and nine. Hinton now throwing to Woods. Complete near the 10.
Talk talking to Phil Fulmer, the offensive coordinator of Tennessee this week. He said, when we get down into scoring territory, as they are right now, we cannot afford a sack. We can't afford a turnover. We have got to come away with something because this Auburn defense is so tough.
Tennessee faces third down here from the 10-yard line. Third and four. Hinton will scramble. Gets away. Flag is down. He has the necessary yardage for the first down.
Boy, Jimmy, the tight end, Von Reeves, number 89, underneath the goalpost, was wide open, waving his arms. Hinton couldn't see him.
We saw Pat Dye react to that. He knew it was coming back.
Talked about Von Reeves right here. He is going to run right here. And watch as he's waving his arms. He is wide open. Nobody even picked him up. Wiley, number 9, goes outside. But he is open by a good 10 yards.
We have clipping on the offensive team. 15-yard penalty from the spot of the foul. Repeat third down.
And this was just what Phil Fulmer, the offensive coordinator, said. We cannot make mistakes when we get down in scoring territory against the Tigers.
We'll check out Sterling Hinton once again, number 16. Sat out all of last year with a broken foot. It's away from Riggins. Horn after him and bumped out of bounds. Doubled up and bumped out by Ogletree and Fernando Horn.
Well, I think what Pat Dye has seen thus far of Sterling Hinton, when they give them inside rush, he is going to scramble outside the pocket. So what you need to do is to have some outside containment. Still come with a rush inside, but have enough guys on the outside to keep him pinned in.
The penalty certainly helped, but the Auburn defense holds up. The Auburn defense that last year did not allow Tennessee to score a touchdown, only two field goals. Now Greg Burke with Lee England on the hold. 37-yard attempt. Just wide to the left. It's his first miss. Had been 2 for 2 on the season. So it was a long drive, took a lot of time, but did not net any points. We're on the campus of the University of Tennessee, founded in the 1700s. Only then it was known as Blount College, named for William Blount, one of the signers of the Declaration of Independence. Auburn has the football back at its own 20-yard line. Tennessee had kept the football for 13 plays and over 5 minutes, but missed on the 37-yard field goal attempt. Stacy Danley in the backfield, joining Alex Strong, the fullback. Again, a flag.
And there's a lot of noise here in this stadium.
Talking about noise, Pat, the conditions, the weather conditions, of course, not ideal today, but I don't see any open seats.
It's incredible. But when you get 93,000 people and you're a quarterback trying to call signals, and I talked to Reggie Slack about this yesterday, he said, hey, I've got to be louder calling plays in the huddle, and I've got to be more vocal at the line of scrimmage.
Hey, Reggie Slack, though, is a poised quarterback. And first and 15, Danley. Met right away by a bunch of volunteers, including Ernest Fields and Mark Fletcher. We were talking about that noise factor with Reggie Slack. Here's what he had to say about it.
This week during practice, we've reviewed some signals with the wide receivers. When we're, you know, in our two-minute game, you know, we've gone over hand signals and things like that. I'm going to have to be more vocal in the huddle and at the line. So, you know, the crowd, it definitely has an effect on our game.
Second down and 15. Danley A gain of four. Mark Moore and Martin Williams on the tackle for Tennessee.
This Tennessee team does a little bit differently on offense this year, Jim, than they did a year ago, is they will flip-flop their offensive line, and that's to take advantage of the great play of Ed King and Bob Meeks, their weak side guard and weak side tackle. Great speed with those guys. They want them pulling and trapping. They're going to lead most of the plays, and so they'll flip-flop that offensive line.
Third down and 11. Listen to the crowd here. Incomplete. Intended for Victor Hall. And Jason Julian, number seven, broke it up for the Volunteers.
Boy, did Jason Julian do a great job of reading that coverage, that play, and just driving on the ball. Free safety just waited, saw the ball was being delivered, and just drove on the ball to make the play. Watch number seven come right in the middle of your screen. This ball is pretty well thrown. But Jason Julian goes right over the top, knocks the ball away, and that's a good play by Julian.
Dickinson to punt. Over his head. Out of the end zone. Safety.
Did the right thing, though, Jim. He did not try to do anything with that ball. Every punter is coached when that situation happens and the ball goes over your head. And again, we talked about the weather being a factor. You're going to get some snaps over your head. He's like Willie Mays back there in center field, has no chance, but doesn't try to pick it up and run it out of the end zone. There's a nice thing. He'll take the 2 points and then they'll play defense. That's a heads-up play by Dickinson.
For Tennessee, and the football coming their way.
Well, Jim, every time there is a safety in a ball game, I think coach's strategy changes because you're going to have an unusual score. You have to be thinking about two-point plays and field goals and how you approach the game a little bit differently. So when you have a safety, particularly this early in the game, it really does change a coach's strategy.
Kick comes to Pickens. Carl Pickens, a freshman, races to the 41-yard line. There's a flag down, back at the 20.
There, Hinton is looking over Johnny Majors to see what Coach Majors wants to get done, and they're going to make him do it again.
We had encroachment by the kicking team, 5-yard penalty and kick over.
That die, we saw him a moment ago talking to the young man, the snapper, Ron Birchfield. He'll be re-kicking. While we have a chance, a reminder, tomorrow, 12:30 Eastern time, the NFL Today gets our action started. We've got a doubleheader coming up for you. 1 o'clock Eastern time. Check your local listings. Many of you will see the Redskins and Saints. Or how about the Tampa Bay Buccaneers, 2-1 on the year, playing at Minnesota, Atlanta at Green Bay. And then late, Rams and 49ers, big NFC West battle. Or the Giants and the Cowboys. Check your local listings. 12:30 Eastern time, however, the NFL Today gets it underway.
Now, Jimmy, I want to see Dick Butkus. He has a piece tomorrow. What's gone wrong with the Minnesota Vikings and all the great expectations of that Minnesota team? I thought they were actually going to be in the Super Bowl myself, but Dick's gone out and going to give us a report.
They opened up the year with such a big win, convincing win over the Houston Oilers, I think that loss to the Bears in week two, just I guess they had that targeted on their calendars and emotionally with not ready to play Pittsburgh last week. Dickinson now from the 15. Boots it away. Boy, he got this one. Caught all of this one.
Wow.
Pickens back to the 22. The wedge is up the middle, and he gets back to about the same spot, to the 42-yard line. Alex Thomas on the tackle for Auburn. 21-yard return.
Well, Woods did get hit, and he's asking to come out on that one. He kind of wishes they hadn't accepted the penalty now, because he didn't really get much more yards than he had.
If you've just joined us, we have a minute and 3 seconds left in the first quarter. And Tennessee leads 2-0 over Auburn. Volunteers drove the football last time without scoring, missing a field goal. Play action. Hinton batted down and intercepted. Billingsley jumped up in the air. I thought he was just going to knock it down, but he held on to it.
What a sensational catch by Billingsley.
Elton Billingsley, a senior from Fairfax, Alabama.
Well, this play started with a very good play-action fake by Sterling Hinton. And this is one thing that this Tennessee team does is fake very well. Watch the fake to Webb. But Billingsley on the left of the screen, number 47, did a great job of leaving, stabs it with one hand. And that's a heads-up play. Now, this is something this Auburn linebackers wanted to do this year, was intercept more balls.
On first down from the 25, James Joseph. Met by Marion Hobby for a yard loss. That is the first interception of the season for Auburn. Did not come up with one in the first two games. And there's Elton Billingsley. What a catch.
You know, again, talking to Quentin Riggins, one of the other linebackers, he said himself and the rest of the linebackers last year dropped too many balls on interceptions. He said, once they're thrown to us, we have to catch them this year. Billingsley did a great job.
Slack to Wasden, complete and a first down at the 12. 14-yard gain on the completion from Reggie Slack.
You know, that's really a heads-up play by the Auburn offensive coaches because they have a man really out of position. Kelly Days, number 39, is ordinarily a strong safety, but because of injuries, he's playing corner today. They threw the short little out route there to Wasden for the easy first down. Heads-up play.
Joseph out, Danley in. On first down, Slack looking at the end zone for Overton. Over his head. Preston Warren over there on the coverage.
Boy, did he ever have him open. Overton was wide open, but Tracy Hayward, number 88, put a little pressure, I think, on Slack. Got the hands up or in the way, and he made it throw it outside the receiver, but that should have been a touch.
There's Tracy Hayworth. These two defensive ends, Hayworth and Hobby, made their presence very much felt here in the first quarter. Second and 10. Stanley tackled. Mark Moore, Casey Rogers over there. Carry was by Kelly Brooks. Crowd is going wild. Big third down play coming up, but we're through the first quarter. We'll return after this message, a word from your local station. Tennessee 2, Auburn nothing as we start the second quarter. And the baseball score, that's 1-0. We've had a few more hits in this game, I guess.
Some very good pitching. A couple of shutouts going there.
Toronto trying to clinch the American League East. But Auburn is driving now. Football is at the Tennessee 14-yard line. Third down and 12.
Very important third down early in this ballgame.
Three receivers for Auburn. Setting up a screen for Danley, and it's way out of bounds.
Well, that was terrific team defense. First the blitz up the middle, and then Daryl Hardy, number 87, read the screen beautifully and covered the back out of the backfield. That is well done. Watch the rush up the middle first. Reggie Slack has no time to set up, but number 87 in orange right there reads the back. Danley going out, and he covers him, so Slack has nowhere to go with the ball. That's tremendous team defense.
Mark Moore was putting pressure in on Slack. He had to throw it away. 30-yard field goal attempt for Win Lyle.
Kickers are kicking over 70% in their field goal. But in a bad weather game like this, the ball is a lot slippier. It doesn't come out as quickly from the center. And this one is blocked because it's too low. No tee here. And again, it looked like it was number 70 right there in the middle.
Charles McCray,
who's an offensive tackle.
Reggie Cobb on first down into the backfield, and Stan Kunis tackles him after a 13-yard gain. Actually, 15-yard pickup.
Take a look at Charles McCray. Most blocks are going to come from the middle and the guy right over the center. Right in here, you're going to see number 70, Charles McCray. Now, he gets blocked pretty well, but he is 6'7". He blows the center back and gets that big old right paw. Again, heads-up play, you put a big guy who's your tallest player right over the center to make the block.
First and 10, Tennessee. Cobb again. And a flag down. Face mask. Dennis Wallace in on the tackle. Looked like a face mask, Pat.
Yeah, right there, the referee, Dick Burleson, is there to call it. Along with the side judge, it was an easy call for him. This is an entirely different Tennessee team as you see the face mask here on Reggie Cobb. Right there's number 30, Wallace, who got his hand in there. But this Tennessee team, after going 0-6 a year ago, would have been easy for them to quit. It's a lot of the same guys on this team now. But Johnny Majors wouldn't let them. They had a great attitude. They rallied, won their last five, and this is an entirely different team. They think they have a legitimate chance to compete for the SEC crown this year.
About a year ago when Auburn won the SEC, not one SEC opponent rushed for 100 yards, a team. And Tennessee already with 83 yards rushing. Good second effort by Roland Poles. Mark Adams has the football after the ball popped loose. Again, Tennessee moving in on 100 yards. No team did that last year in SEC play against Auburn. The safety after the poor snap. Tennessee did have a field goal opportunity, missed, and then Auburn's attempt from 30 yards blocked just moments ago. 2-0, ball at the Auburn 48-yard line. Webb is the tailback. Timeout, Tennessee. 13 minutes, 35 seconds left of the second quarter. And it's 2 Tennessee by 2.
Some thought the bad weather would dampen the enthusiasm in attendance here in Knoxville, but no way. Third largest crowd in history, 95,341. But when you look at the size of on-campus stadiums, Auburn shouldn't be intimidated. They play before 85,000 people. Here, Tennessee, over 91,000 capacity, but that all may change, Jim and Pat. They're talking about expanding this stadium to up towards of 103,000. That would pass what? Michigan.
Are they going to let in more students or what? How do you fill that up? Oh, no, the dreaded wave they're doing out there, all 96,000 of them.
Wave in the rain. Second down and 8 from the 48 of Auburn. Hinton. Fumbles. I believe it's recovered by Auburn. Larry Young, number 99.
And this is something that Tennessee has not done much this year, is turn the ball over. Coming in today's game, they had 3 fumbles, but no interceptions. But again, Hinton, it was good pass coverage that really set up the recovery there by Young. Hinton has to come out of the pocket because he's chased out by David Rocker inside. Rocker gets his hand on the ball. It slips out again. It's very wet down there. And then number 99, Young, makes the recovery. But when that ball sometimes, Jim, comes up off a wet turf, a quarterback gets nothing but water on his hands.
And that's two turnovers, a pass interception, and now the fumble. Joseph in the backfield, play action pick to Joseph. Slacks pass over the head of Alex Strong. We got another update, so we send you back to New York where it's nice and dry with Greg Humble.
Jim, the shocker of the day comes out of the ACC. Under a minute to play, 4th-and-13 for Clemson, trailing Duke by 4. The pass for Gary Cooper is incomplete. The Blue Devils run out the clock for their first win over Clemson in Durham since 1975. Serious blow to Clemson's national championship hope, Jim and Pat.
Wow. That is really a shocker. Clemson in Virginia next week on CBS.
Virginia's quarterback, Sean Moore, thrown for 7 touchdowns already this year. Looking forward to seeing him.
Slack complete to Hall. Oh, what a run. He's down with a flag down at the 31-yard line. Gain of 20. Kelly Days on the tackle.
And by the looks of some of the disappointment on the Auburn players, I think they may have called a low block on Alexander Wright, the wide receiver, who was just trying to help Victor Hall across the way.
Coming back.
Yep. This is the thing about this Auburn team, though. You will see them run an awful lot of crossing routes off a play-action pass. That time it was Victor Hall. They'll also do it with Alexander Wright, their speedster on the outside. They run as many crossing routes as anybody in college football because they like to get their receivers a chance to run after the catch.
This is Pat Dye's 99th game as the Auburn coach. 73-23-2. Now they're trying to decide on the placement. The Volunteer defensive line is all the way back at the 35, but the football, let's see. Yep, they're going to race it back.
Clipping penalty during the run, 15 yards from the spot of the foul. Repeat, second down, spot of the foul.
To look at the left part of the screen, I believe it was Alexander Wright, number 18, who's trying to clear the way for the tight end, Victor Hall. And he pushes him right from behind. Yeah, that is a clip. It wasn't a violent clip, but nonetheless, he did push him from behind. Still, really a silly foul. But nonetheless, that's the clip.
Talk about silly. The crowd's booing because the ball was spotted at the 37-yard line. Once the ball was put on the ground, they ran it back up to the 48.
Well, it's marked from
Tennessee.
Yeah, it's marked from the spot of the foul, not the line of scrimmage, and that's what Pat Dye was complaining about.
Ed King, the star guard, is not in there. Brad Johnson replacing him, swinging it out to Joseph. And just a yard gain. James Joseph had his career high in the last game against Southern Mississippi, ran for 149 yards. Just a junior from Phoenix City, Alabama.
And James Joseph can do a lot of different things for this team. He'll play tailback in the I formation. He can play some fullback, and then he'll catch the ball out of the backfield for you as well.
3rd-and-6. Slack. Oh, almost picked off. Jason Julian had it read.
That is 2 nice plays by Jason Julian, the free safety, number 7. This is the guy who came real here really as a kicker. But last year he really came on, number 7, right there in the middle of the screen. Watch his eyes. He reads the pattern beautifully and drives on it immediately. That's well-coached team. He read the pattern, drove on the ball, and knocked his second pass away from a receiver.
That will keep an eye on the snap. From Ron Birchfield. Dickinson to punt. Right in his hands and he drops it. Still gets it away. End over end. Ball down at the 21-yard line. That could have been a disaster. 26-yard punt. Tennessee with the football in the lead. Tennessee clings to the two-point lead. Going against an Auburn defense that, as Craig Ogletree told us, has one cardinal rule.
First thing, it starts with effort, you know, all-out effort, getting to the ball. And when I first got here, I didn't realize that, and I guess that's what kept me out of playing, you know, early as I should have, I think, because I wasn't accustomed to running to the ball like, you know, like you do here. And they want maximum effort, effort to take over anything. If you make a mistake on a play, do it going all out, full speed. And, you know, that's the one thing they emphasize here, year-round, maximum effort.
Jim, he plays so hard, sometimes they have to give him a break. But his coaches say, I hate when he's out of the ball game because he makes big plays.
A new quarterback for Tennessee, Andy Kelly. Kelly gives to Cobb. Cobb into the secondary. He may go. Touchdown, Tennessee. 79 yards. The extra point try. Out of Lee England's hold. That's the longest run, the longest touchdown run of Reggie Cobb's career.
Watch how patient Reggie Cobb here lined up in the I formation is. A lot of guys will rush the hole. Reggie Cobb does not. He waits and waits, picks his way through the hole, and then when he finds it, number 70, Charles McRae, just buried an inside linebacker. Then he picks up a great block by Morgan, the wide receiver, number 80. He runs, as he said, as much with his eyes as he does with his feet. And he picked up two or three nice blocks, and he read every one of them.
He straddled that sideline, but never stepped out after a sensational freshman year in which Reggie Cobb scored 20 touchdowns and ran for nearly 1,200 yards. He came back last year, had half the season, was suspended from the team in February of this year. Suspended for reasons never announced publicly. Was let back on the team this summer. He told us yesterday, I've got a lot to prove, a lot to prove. Everyone had me on all the preseason teams last year. This year, no one had me on any team at all. They just forgot about me.
He's a guy you don't want to forget about because he does have an awful lot of ability.
With it 9-0, the kick comes to Anderson to the 26.
Whoever would be around Reggie Cobb's locker after the game, but watch the block of left tackle, number 70, right here. And the next guy, this is the tight end, the tackle right here, number 70, Charles McRae, as he just flattens the inside linebacker. Same guy who made the block a little bit earlier. Blocked the field goal.
Charles McRae. He blocked the field goal. Came up with a big block there. First down, Danley.
We talked about the offensive line, too, of both of these teams earlier, Jim, and Charles McRae, number 70 for Tennessee, who made that block again. He is a guy that's really going to help this Tennessee team run the football this year in the SEC, and that's what they felt they had to do to be competitive. And then he blocked the field goal attempt earlier, got that 6'7 height up, played defense a year ago. His coaches wanted him on offense to make plays like that.
Three wide receivers for Auburn. Second and eight, and the slack gets away from one. Steps out of bounds. And a flag down.
They're going to call a late hit against Reggie Slack. Well, the thing about Reggie Slack, and you mentioned it a little bit earlier, Jim, is his composure. Even though his team is struggling here a little bit, they're down by 9 points. He is the guy who has remarkable composure.
Dead ball foul, personal foul, 15 yards on the defense. First down.
Well, his teammates say they have never seen him rattled. And that's what you like to have when you got a quarterback in there.
Well, that goes a long way. Again, when you play in stadiums like this where it's very, very hostile to play, I think in the Southeastern Conference, you have the toughest places for visiting teams to win. If you have a quarterback that keeps his composure, that rubs off on his teammates.
The Orioles have now taken the lead on the Blue Jays. Danley and Joseph in the backfield together. Pass is batted away, almost intercepted. Mark Fletcher had a shot at it, but I believe it was Marion Hobby who deflected it.
Yeah, it was Hobby. He is the guy that's made four tackles, two for losses, and now blocks a pass. Again, the move from defensive tackle to defensive end, watch number 90, was an important move for this Tennessee defense. They went to the four-man line because they needed to get more pressure on the runner, on the runners and the quarterback. He was trying to get blocked by Ed King, threw King away, and then got that big hand up.
The Iron Man from Irondale, Alabama, having a big afternoon. Second and 10, look out! Slack is pummeled by Cedric Klein.
Boy, that hurts. Believe me. And there's no excuse for this. Protection comes first. There should never, far left of the screen, right here, you're going to see number 30, Cedric Klein, the outside lineman. But from the backside, that should never happen. Stacy Danley, number 32, has got to pick him up. He went out in the route, and that gave Klein a free shot at the quarterback flag.
Loss of six. Third, actually seven. Third and 17. Flack chased out. Pass through the hands. It's out of bounds anyway. Intended for Overton. Punting time for Auburn. Sean Walker was trying to run him down. Reggie Slack. Pass was thrown away. Chris Dickinson. Little slap to the helmet. Dropped the football last time. This one's over his head again. Over his head, destined for the end zone, it looks like. Dickinson will try to run out of it for a safety again. This time they had a new snapper. They had a new snapper, Travis Galloway. Same result.
Yeah, earlier it was number 53, Ron Birchfield. They went to number 57, Galloway, with the same result. And again, what happens with a wet ball there, Jim, the ball is so heavy, you think you have to get a lot more on it because it's so wet. And twice it's gone over Dickinson's head, but twice Dickinson's done the right thing. Here you're going to see Galloway the snap. No chance for Dickinson. Absolutely no chance. But again, it gets the ball and then runs out of the end zone for the safety. This is something punters practice, believe it or not, every week. Just drills like that. Two centers, two different centers, but the same result. Like a center fielder who had just had a line drive hit right over his head.
Cedric Klein was running him down. Cedric Klein, number 30. He had made the big hit on Reggie Slack two plays before. Klein's philosophy going into this game. Cedric Klein said, if it moves, hit it. And he's done it.
I noticed how you were very still around him yesterday.
Yes, I was. Not moved. Petrified. It's now, Pat, 11-0 Tennessee.
You have said it a couple times. Weather was going to be a factor in the special teams today.
Free kick comes to Pickens, the freshman, returning to the 45-yard line. Whole wave of Auburn tacklers.
I think this is a very important series, Jim, for this Auburn defense. They're struggling now on offense. They're down by 11 points, 10 minutes left in the half. They need to shut Andy Kelly and this offense down there, force a punt, and give Reggie Slack at least one more chance before halftime to get something on the board.
Well, Andy Kelly was the quarterback for one play. It was a handoff, and Reggie Cobb took it 79 yards. He stays in at quarterback. Gives it to Chuck Webb near the 50. We take it back downstairs to John Dockery.
You know, Jim, the weather's played an important factor today. They do try to keep the ball clean. Mike Benedict does it here. They're in a garbage bag, four on either side, and the way they keep them clean is and dry is they have an absorbent substance, much like sawdust, inside, or else they just towel them off and send them in fresh every play. So the ball should be relatively dry. Now back to you, Jim.
Doc, I wonder if they're keeping them dry when Auburn's on offense.
Maybe he's not on that other sideline.
It's a home field advantage.
Second and six. Webb trying to spin loose. He'll lose yardage. David Rocker and Craig Ogletree in the backfield. Again, Tennessee now becomes the first team in 2 years of SEC play to rush for 100 yards against Auburn. Did not allow it last year, the Tigers. Rushing yards minus 20.
And that is a very much a surprise as well, and give the Tennessee defense a lot of credit, because the offensive line of Auburn coming in today was thought of as the best in the Southeastern Conference.
Morgan to the left, Harper in motion. Poles in the backfield. Kelly's first pass, throws it away. He had pressure. Pressure coming up from the secondary. Corey Barlow in on him in a hurry.
Well, that is a dangerous pass when you throw it out in the flat with nothing on the ball. Barlow is normally a corner, and it was a corner blitz. This Auburn defense ordinarily doesn't have to blitz at all, but you have to. They feel that they have to change the rhythm of this game some, so they're even blitzing now.
Kent Elmore will kick. Wasden on the return. Good kick it is. Fair catch called. Wasden will let it go, and it goes into the end zone. Touchback. 51-yard punt. We're nearing the midway point of the second quarter. It's been all Tennessee over Auburn. Auburn and Tennessee have been feuding since 1900. 1985, Vols beat number one Auburn. A little roar to tell you that no one has ever lost this game and still won the SEC. Pat, you know what? Probably never will. It's the SEC opener for both teams. Johnny Majors Volunteers 3-0 on the year, including an impressive victory at UCLA. Very impressive today against Pat Dye and Auburn. Pitch, Joseph for two. Tackled by Sean Walker, Tracy Hayworth. Joseph and Danley, they alternate a tailback. It doesn't seem to bother either player. We talked to James Joseph about that, Pat. They actually like to kid each other.
They seem to have a lot of fun with it, actually. Danley says about Joseph, he's the best guy running for 5 yards he's ever seen. Because you like to see him right in front of him at fullback.
In other words, I'm the breakaway guy, right?
Exactly right.
Second and eight. Slack going long. Pass is caught by Greg Taylor at the 35 of Tennessee. 42 yards.
What a great catch by Greg Taylor, and he used his body again on a day, a wet day like this. Sometimes you just can't use just your hands, and Greg Taylor will fool you. You think of him as a possession receiver. The Tennessee defense thought of him as a third and 5 to 6 yard receiver. That time he gets behind the free safety for a well-thrown ball by Slack.
So, changes things in a hurry. Joseph again running left. Ed Kingsway, but no gain. Fletcher and Ernest Fields make the tackle.
Number 36, Mark Fletcher, they made that tackle, as you just called, Jim. He is a guy that they say is getting as much out of his ability as anybody on this defensive team. gives you everything that he has every single day. They're very happy with the play of Mark Fletcher.
Only a sophomore. Baltimore now up 3-1 on the Jays. Second and 11. Joseph up the middle. Running room. First down to the 20-yard line. Jason Julian makes the tackle. A 16-yard gain for Joseph.
And it was right guard Ed King that time and the fullback Alex Strong that made a huge hole for James Joseph. Look at Ed King, number 67. He is the right guard right here and the fullback right here. Both of them clear the way for Joseph. Terrific hook block. Steps in. He gets some help with John Hudson. The fullback, Strong, does a job. And that is a 15-yard hole right there.
Best run of the day for Auburn. They call Ed King the human highlight film. I've never heard of an offensive lineman getting that kind of title. Slack throws it away. Overton in the area, number 4. Slack is 5 for 14 for 92 yards.
And Preston Warren, number 21 for the Volunteers, was on the coverage there. He is a junior defensive back who has done a remarkable job this year. Shut down Clarkson Hines, the All-American receiver from Duke a few weeks ago. And you watch tapes of this guy, and you get more and more impressed every time you watch him. You don't see too many guys wide open in his neighborhood.
Second and 10. Joseph. Maybe 4. Fields and Bradley. Shazon Bradley on the tackle. We got a story down on the sidelines again with John Dockery. Doc, take it away.
Jim, I asked the people on the Auburn sideline, the centers, what was the problem? Was it a wet ball? And they said, well, not much. And then they were very quiet. I asked some of the other Auburn folks, and they said, the problem is not with the wet ball, but... Jim, back to you.
Third down and 6. Joseph will not have the first down. Mark Moore and Jason Julian in the area.
And a free safety again. Jason Julian did a great job of coming up earlier in the game, number 7. We saw him knock a couple of balls down. But at playing free safety in the Southeastern Conference, you have to be a great tackler because you're the last line of defense most times. And that is exactly what Jason Julian is, a great tackler.
Tennessee brings in a freshman defensive lineman, James Wilson. There is a timeout on the field. Auburn has called the timeout. Tennessee leading by the awkward score of 11-0. In the rain at Neyland Stadium, we welcome you back. The drizzle has been here all day, but what about the play on special teams? Auburn has missed a field goal. It was blocked, and 2 snaps over the punter's head for safeties.
And now Auburn is going to use their third snapper, John Hudson, the ordinarily the center. I talked to him before the game when it was pouring rain down there. I said, John, does this rain bother you in your snaps? He said, absolutely not.
Gwynn Lyle will attempt another 30-yarder. Dickinson on the hold. Hudson's snap is perfect. Hold is good, and the kick makes it in there. Auburn is on the board.
And with 5 minutes left, they're thinking the 3 points there. They're going to need a touchdown and the 2-point conversion to try to tie the ball game up. Again, this time, watch the offensive linemen, how they hug one another to make sure this one's not going to get blocked. You see all those big bodies inside. Hudson and King and Johnson, number 52. Selby's number 78. There's going to be absolute no penetration. And here's the kick by Lyle. Again, with bad weather like this, the ball generally is going to come out a little bit lower, off the kicker's foot.
Lyle nailed that one. Good snap from number 66, John Hudson. Lyle, by the way, in 1987 here at Neyland Stadium, kicked 2 field goals over 50 yards, 52 and 55 yards. That being his career long, as a matter of fact, right from right here. New man on the kick, however, it will not be Gwynn Lyle. It's Jim Von Weil. kick going out of bounds. While we have a moment, we remind you that tomorrow, doubleheader action on CBS. Early, you'll be getting one of these games, the Redskins and Saints, Tampa Bay, Minnesota, or the Atlanta Falcons and Green Bay. Green Bay putting a lot of points on the board.
Well, they are.
Oof. What a comeback they almost pulled off last week against the Rams. Rams will be playing the 49ers in the second game of the doubleheader. Some will see the Giants and Cowboys. It all gets started 12:30 Eastern time with the NFL today.
Jim, you know, a real nice piece in the NFL today on Dexter Manley, the Washington Redskins, admitted last year in Congress, testifying in front of Congress, that he couldn't read.
In tears.
Absolutely. A very, very warm piece on Dexter Manley.
Von Wiles kick coming to Pickens. Carl Pickens at the nine. Try the left side. This man has speed. No flag out of bounds. Crowd was wanting it. Out of bounds at the 32-yard line. Tennessee has won 8 straight games after, again, losing its first 6 at the start of last year. Look at the other win streaks in the nation. Notre Dame, Fresno State, Miami. But Clemson, it came to a close today. Clemson's win streak is over after Duke's 21-17 shocker. That was a shocker because Clemson had a favorable schedule after beating Florida State. This could have been a national championship possibility for Danny Ford this year. Flag is down on the field. A carry by Chuck Webb for just a couple.
5 minutes left here in the second quarter. What Tennessee would like to see themselves do is, first of all, grind out a few first downs so they don't have to give the ball back to the Auburn offense, and then get themselves in a position to give their kicker, Greg Burke, a chance to at least get 3 more. They haven't had much success throwing the football today, as Sterling Henton is back in the game. But they have had tremendous success running the football.
Holding on the line of scrimmage on the offense, 10 yards and repeat the down.
So now with their backed up here, Tennessee has got to make sure, Jim, they don't make another mistake. No sacks, no turnovers. Don't make it easy on Auburn.
Vince Moore comes in as a receiver at the top of your screen. First and 20, and Hinton is calling a timeout. CFA College Football will be back in just a moment.
Robert Nalen came to Tennessee in 1925 to teach military science and agreed to help coach the football team. He stressed mental preparation and soon became recognized as the top defensive strategist of modern football. In 1939, Nalen's Tennessee team did not allow a point in 10 regular season games. The only time in the past 50 years that a team's goal line has never been crossed during a season. This is Brent Musburger recalling the great traditions of college football.
We're back, and Hinton trying to run with it. He'll lose yardage here at Neyland Stadium. Ogletree, tackle for loss, makes the tackle for the loss.
Well, what a nice play by Craig Ogletree there. Really hung in, forced Hinton to come inside for the sack. Puts them in second and 20. Very big down for this Auburn defense with 4 minutes 23 remaining in the second quarter.
Ogletree, a senior, one of only 3 senior starters on this Auburn defense. Webb. Look at him go. He may have the first down. Ramsey and Barlow, he does have the first down. 23-yard gain to the 46.
And Jim, that is a huge hole again. We have seen holes when either team is running the ball. It has been sensationally large holes. That shouldn't happen on second and 20 because a draw is what most teams are going to call when they're backed up and have a lead. But it's 79, Eric Still, who made a nice block. Mislinski, number 50, makes a nice block. And again, Chuck Webb picks his way, reads those blocks very well.
Flag down. Okay, this Cobb-Webb combination has netted 194 yards rushing in the first half, averaging 8 yards a carry.
baseball foul. False start. Movement by the interior lineman on the offense.
And Jim, they really have complimented Cobb and Webb, complimented one another so very well. Webb has done a great job so far of running from tackle to tackle on draws and little isolation plays. Cobb has done a nice job of getting to the corner of the defense when he ran with the one for 79 yards for the touchdown. But he has been very good on the outside while Webb has run strongly inside.
Only one individual player had rushed for 100 yards against Auburn in the last 27 games, and that was Sammy Smith in last year's Sugar Bowl. Cobb is already well over 100. Fumbles the football. Tennessee holds on to it.
Now they're using an awful lot of time here. 3 minutes. They have one timeout remaining. And they've got to be, Johnny Majors has to be thinking about getting something more on the board.
Amsler recovered his own fumble. He goes out, and Webb comes in. Larry Young made the strip on the play, but Amsler got it back. Second and 11. Webb on the delay. Smothered by Quentin Riggins. Quentin Riggins, one of the returning stars from this Auburn defense of 1988. First team All-SEC, second team All-America.
Quentin Riggins has battled his size. People have always said he's too small, but he really has a huge heart. Plays hard every single down, Quentin Riggins does. Hides inside, hides behind his defensive lineman, and he is going to make people miss on the block to make a lot of plays like he did right there.
Third down and 8. Pat Dye's team hustles off the field just in time. Gets away from Ogletree. Hinton. Lobs it up long, looking for Woods. He makes the catch at the 15. Excellent timing and judgment by Thomas Woods, outsmarting the defenders in a 37-yard gain.
What a nice adjustment by Thomas Woods. I think the underthrown deep ball is a great opportunity for a wide receiver to make a play like this. Thomas Woods waits to the very last moment to go up. And there's three defenders there. Wallace is there, Stankunas is there. But he waited to the last moment to go up and get the ball.
Webb on first and 10 from the 15, picks up 4. Right into the heart of that defense, Richard Shea on the tackle.
This is the perfect scenario for this Tennessee offense. Use the clock with 1:16 remaining in the half. They still have a timeout. Johnny wants them on the ball, keep it moving. They use as much of the clock as you can and still get the ball in the end zone.
Second down and 6. Amsler for a yard. Clock continues to move, 51 seconds. Walter Tate on the last tackle for Auburn.
Well, they really should be up on the line of scrimmage. Now they're gonna get themselves in a bit of a bind here.
Just the one timeout left. The down clock is at 10.
Yeah, Johnny Majors, yeah.
We better hurry. 5 seconds on the down clock. That is not using your time judiciously. 1 second was left on the down clock. They had to call the timeout.
And this is something you practice every single week. Your two-minute drill, the use of the clock. Sterling Hinton just did not do a good job of getting his team out of the huddle. Really, I don't think they should have been in a huddle at all, Jim. Very critical down for the SEC championship, even though it's the first game of the SEC season. Very important SEC game down here. Third and 5. This Auburn defense needs to shut down this Tennessee offense so they don't go into the locker room with less than an 8-point difference. Now,
What Tennessee has to do on offense, and Sterling Hinton has got to do, is get one ball into the end zone on third and five. You don't want to come up with something short of getting the ball into the end zone.
Coming up at halftime, just a few minutes from now, we'll send you back to Greg Gumbel. He'll be joined once again this week by Mike Francesa. We're talking about college football, telling you all the stories, scores, and highlights from today. Third and five. Harper in motion. Hinton. He'll have to get out of bounds. He did not get out of bounds.
The kicking team needs to get out there. Here they come.
He has the first down, but kicking team is now running on the field.
So first down, they really could have thrown one ball out of bounds and stopped the clock.
Burke, field goal try. It's good.
Well, Jim, they got 3 points on the scoreboard, but they really should have had at least one or two efforts into the end zone. Not well-used last 2 minutes of the ballgame.
It's a new way to tally 14 points. A field goal, a touchdown, an extra point, and two safeties. Big wins over Pacific, as you would expect, 55-0, 24-3 over the Southern Mississippi team that had upset Florida State the first weekend of the season. But he wasn't sure his team had really been tested. He was not certain that his defense was up to par to last year's squad.
Well, he was really concerned about this team because they haven't been tested, but at halftime, he's going to have to really talk about it to his offensive line.
Let's take you back down to John Dockery.
You know, Jim, while we have a moment, I'd like you to meet Lester McClain, a man who broke the color barrier in the SEC some 21 years ago. And, Lester, I know you're enjoying this game, but why did you pick Tennessee back then?
Well, Tennessee was a home school. Of course, I'm from Nashville, and that's where football is really played here at Tennessee.
What was it like for a black player then?
Well, it was new to everyone involved, the players, the fans, but it was great. You could tell by the sound.
Thank you, Lester, and good luck to you. Now back to you, Jim.
All right, Doc, Lester McCray, honored here today at Neyland Stadium. We've been in rain throughout, but it's a first-half deluge delivered by the Tennessee Volunteers. That's the end of the first half with the score, Tennessee 14, Auburn 3. It's been a big day for one of the great running backs of all time, Gale Sayers. And Greg Gumbel has that story in New York. Greg, tell us a bit. Getting ready for the second half, it is now time to present this week's Toyota Leadership Award to team players who have been singled out by their school's coaching and faculty staff for outstanding performance in the areas of team contributions, academics, and citizenship. Today's game team leadership winners, Wynn Lyle from Auburn. Wynn is a pre-med major from Auburn, Alabama. And Eric Still from Tennessee. Eric, a transportation major from Germantown, Tennessee. Toyota donates a check in the amount of $1,000 to each school's general scholarship fund. Jim Nance, Pat Hayden, John Dockery, Neyland Stadium in Knoxville. Fourth-ranked Auburn will kick to Tennessee to start the second half, trailing 14-3. Von Wild's kick, headed for Pickens. Carl Pickens at the one. To the 20. Tackled by Alex Thomas. The statistics from the first half.
Really staggering, Jim. Just staggering to me how well Tennessee ran the ball.
Over 200 yards rushing in the first half. Average per play, a 5-yard advantage per play for Tennessee. Cobb, 145 yards on 9 rushes. Hinton is the quarterback for the Vols to start the second half. Cobb is the tailback. Cobb on the pitch. Pickup of 3. Wrapped up by Darryl Crawford. Pat Dye spoke briefly on the way out to the sideline with John Dockery and said that either the defense was left behind at Auburn, didn't make the trip up here, or it's in the NFL right now.
Well, remember, he lost eight guys on defense, particularly the down three. Tracy Rocker, Benji Rowland, and Ron Stallworth, all guys who played very, very well for him last year. And he said, we are going to be tested today. I don't know how good this defense is. So far, this defense has not met the challenge. But give the Tennessee offensive line a lot of credit, Jim. There have been some huge holes.
Morgan left, Moore in the slot left on second and seven. Cobb picks up two to the 25. Crawford again on the tackle. Pat, the conditions here are getting more severe. The weather has been raining all day, but now it's coming down hard.
And this game will be won or lost in the second half by turnovers. The officials are drying the ball off before each play, but they don't have a towel over the ball, which is a little bit unusual, before the ball is snapped.
Third down and five. It's Cobb. Cobb hit by Stankunas, but barrels his way near the 30 and near a first down.
Well, that is a, if they do pick up the first down, that's a big first down, because every opening series in each half, I think, is the most critical. It just sets the tone for the rest of the day. And they came out and hammered the ball and picked up what could be a very important first down for Tennessee. Problem, I think, Jim, and the reason Tennessee has gained those 200 some odd yards, and they did pick up the first, is that the defensive linemen aren't keeping people off the inside linebackers. The defensive linemen aren't keeping guys off Quentin Riggins and Darrell Crawford, the two inside linebackers for Auburn. They're getting blocked, so that when that running back gets into the past the line of scrimmage, he's already in the secondary before anybody has a chance to get to him.
There's a look at Riggins, first and 10 for Tennessee. Cobb, fourth successive carry. That's only a yard. Ogletree on the tackle for Auburn along with Riggins.
Over the years, this Auburn defense has done a great job of stripping the ball from teams. Last year, they caused a couple of fumbles against Tennessee with some big hits and stripping the ball. They use that. They get a lot of helmets around the ball. And then when they have the guy standing up, two or three other defenders will start knocking the ball away. They create turnovers.
Second down and nine. Webb replaces Cobb in the backfield. Out of the eye. Fake to Webb. Hinton looking past, but will run. All kinds of room near midfield, right at the 50. Corey Barbo on the tackle for the Tigers after 19 yards picked up on the play by Hinton.
Well, when you have a respect for a guy like Sterling Hinton on the outside of the defense, and watch Craig Ogletree, number 94, he did a nice job of taking away the outside. But you need some inside help. Some guys from the inside have to hustle back in and make that play. But because Hinton has been on the corner of the defense outside, they played him way wide and opened up a huge hole inside.
First and 10 from right at the 50. Webb will lose 2 yards. Riggins and Ogletree. The two are roommates, Riggins and Ogletree.
Again, they were saying that they believe this defense had a chance to be a very good defense. They thought they had some good guys up in front of them. And in this second half, thus far, we have seen Quentin Riggins, number 41, be a different player. He's made two or three tackles thus far in this drive.
Riggins was telling us that he worked for the third straight summer as an undercover security guard at a department store in Alabama. Had to chase down one big Batman fan this summer who tried to get off of a lot of the Batman things. He caught him. Hinton's pass is caught. Caught by Adams, Mark Adams. Sophomore from Virginia Beach, Virginia.
What kind of a surprise throw, really, when you think you're ahead 14-3, up by 11 points, and the weather conditions like that. Kind of a surprise throw, but a good play there, a good reception by Mark Adams, because that ball was thrown away from him, but did a good job of getting his body in the way and stopping and slowing down the throw.
Look at the amount of water collected on this artificial surface at Neyland Stadium. Third and five. Webb short at the first down. Tackled by Lamar Rogers and Elton Billingsley.
Punting situation coming up. We've seen Auburn have a very difficult time with their snaps in these situations.
Andy Kelly, the backup quarterback, and the backup punter is in. Preston Warren, the up back on fourth and two. Kelly, little pooch punt, comes to Wasden on a fair catch and a knee at the 10. 32-yard punt, did the job. It backs up Auburn inside of the 20, and the Tigers are trailing.
As you can see, the rain is now coming down in torrents here in Knoxville as Auburn trails by 11. I talked to Pat Sullivan, the quarterback coach of Auburn, and he told me despite the fact that they brought 48 balls and they are changing them almost every play, that the ball is slippery, it's heavy, and Reggie Slack is having his problems holding on to it.
All right, Doc, first and 10. Danley, written down by Hayworth. Maybe a gain of two on the play.
Well, the change to the 4-3 defense by the Tennessee coaching staff this year has really made a very large difference, Jim. They went to that four-man line because they felt to win in the Southeastern Conference, you had to stop the run. And they got two guys at the outside, Tracy Hayworth, number 88, and Marion Hobby, number 90, who've done a great job of just that today, stopping the run.
Second down and 8. Is caught by Joseph, but hit immediately by Mark Fletcher. Only a 3-yard gain to the 15.
Well, I tell you, Pat Dye has got to think this is an incredibly big down. Third and 5 with the way his cunning team has operated thus far, backed up. This is a very important down for Pat Sullivan, who sends in the play in this Auburn offense.
Auburn is 0 for 5 in third down conversion. The Tigers face third and 5. Three receivers in the game for quarterback Reggie Slack. He gives it instead to Danley. First down and more to the 40-yard line. Fletcher again rides him down. 25 yards, Pat, on the play by Stacy Danley.
And, Jim, that is a big play, believe me. 25 yards, but at that point in that game, that is exactly what this team needs. And Stacy Danley doesn't dance around in the hole. Watch if these guys come down inside here and block and create a huge hole for Danley on the little draw play. Terrific block there by Ed King and Mark Rose, too. And then Danley doesn't waste any time getting upfield.
On first and 10, Slack with the wet football. Throwing for Wasden. And Preston Warren coming on. He was looking at interception. He had 5 last year, including 2 run back for touchdowns.
He picked one off this year as well. And what Preston Warren does so well, he has so much confidence in his ability. He'll make a quarterback think the receiver's open. And then as soon as that quarterback throws the ball, because he plays the wide side, boy, then he just drives on it. What a great play there.
No one has left. 96,000 on hand. Second down, stuffed. Joseph, hit immediately by Martin Williams and Tracy Hayward. That last 25-yard run by Danley put the Auburn Tigers into positive yards rushing for the day. Not until the third quarter.
But, you know, they do mark off the yardage of those snaps that go over the punter's head. That is counted as negative rushing yards.
Auburn with 22 yards rushing on the day. All totaled when you include that, Pat. Third down and 9. Pass intended for Greg Taylor. Jason Julian again on the coverage. Been an adventure all day on the punting team for Auburn. John Hudson will snap it. If you're just joining us, 2 snaps went over Dickinson's head in the first half for safety. This one splashes around and stays inbounds. Really doing the job.
He's got a nice roll on that one.
44 yards in all. We're halfway through the third quarter. Tennessee still on top by 14-3. Johnny Majors won a national championship as the coach at Pitt in 1976, now in his 13th year in Tennessee. Always has been a favorite son here. Hall of Famer. National Football Foundation was a tailback and a single wing formation for the Volunteers. 1956, runner-up to Paul Hornung for the Heisman Trophy. He's returned home. The faithful behind him now. That was somewhat shaky ground a year ago at this time after six opening losses. Fumble on the exchange. Hinton gets it right back.
And we said the fumbles, the turnovers in this kind of game, in this half, will determine who wins and loses it. But this is an offensive lineman's type of game. And Johnny Majors has told his offensive lineman, hey, guys, right here, we need a couple of first downs. You have to grind out a couple of first downs. We don't want to punt the ball too often in this part of the field. And, you know, offensive linemen love these kind of games. They rise to the occasion. They love to get the uniforms dirty. They wish this thing were on grass.
Looking at the snap from John Fisher. Second and 11. Roland Poles. Poles to the 18. Darrell Crawford, David Rocker combined for Auburn on the stop.
I'm really surprised those officials still really aren't putting a towel over the ball as it lays there. See, the ball boys are right there. Now, ordinarily, the official, the towels are pretty cheap. You can actually lay a couple of dry ones over the football. The NCAA requires you to come in with 12 new footballs each game. But as John Dockery reported earlier, Auburn brought, 50 or so of their own.
Third down and 7. Cobb back in there, and Hinton calls a timeout from the line of scrimmage. So, 6 minutes, 12 seconds left in the third quarter. Tennessee, 14-3. Knoxville, Tennessee, the home of the Vols, right on the center, the campus of the University of Tennessee. A touchdown, a field goal, and 2 safeties, along with the extra point. And it's 14-3. Tennessee is not only impressive, it's also very youthful. 5 senior starters and 7 sophomores.
This is a team that is coming on in this conference. I think Johnny Majors knew that a year ago when he got off to that 0-6 start, knew he had to play some young guys a year ago, hoping that they would mature, and they have this season.
It's third down and 7. Cobb in the backfield. Delay give to Cobb to the 23, short of a first down. Tackled by Fernando Horn.
No, Jim, I think if you're Pat Dye in this situation, you have to think about attempting to block a punt, maybe. Your offense is really struggling. Make something happen in the special teams. Bad weather, everybody's worried about the snap. Could be a bad snap. You maybe want to come after the punter this time.
Kent Elmore is the punter. Senior from Florida. Chad Gooden on the snap. Good snap. Good boot. Wasden driven back to his 31. Hayworth after him. And he's down at the 35-yard line by Casey Rogers. Tomorrow, doubleheader day on CBS National Football League. Week 4. Redskins and Saints, Bucks and Vikes, and Atlanta, Green Bay. You'll see one of those games early, and then late, big game out of the West. Rams and 49ers, yeah. Giants and Dallas. Who do you like?
I like the Rams. It's my old team. I'll have to feed up with a coffee table for that one, believe me.
Slacks pass, caught. Wow. Caught. That's Alexander Wright for the first time today.
Boy, that is a nice throw in this kind of weather. We talked about Reggie Slack having those very large hands and composure. And Alexander Wright, number 18, who's really came here as a track man, is feeling more and more comfortable as a receiver catching the ball over the middle.
Picks up 19 on that play. Alexander Wright scored 4 touchdowns in the opener against Pacific. Joseph. Tackled by Mark Moore. How about the Air Force Academy? Another win today for D. Dallas and company.
Just some of the highlights that Greg had of D. Dallas. He cuts back as well as anybody I've ever seen.
Team could be very easily 6-0 facing Notre Dame in mid-October. Joseph again on the carry. Fumbles. Picked up by Hayward. Tennessee football. Cedric Klein knocked it loose.
And Jim, there were about six orange jerseys around the ball carrier. Hayworth made the recovery. Cedric Klein knocked it loose, as you said, number 30. He's the guy that also sacked Reggie Slack a little earlier in the game. But watch how many orange jerseys. Guys, not staying blocked. Coming off block. There's four guys right there. Klein gets it loose, and Hayworth, the defensive end, makes the recovery. Running all the way over on the other side of the field.
Of course, in college football, unless you catch the fumble in midair, you're not able to return it. And if you saw in that replay, Hayworth had nothing but open room ahead of him, but cannot advance it. That's Fletcher being helped off the field. First and 10. Webb on the carry. The big freshman gets to the 47-yard line. Frankie Stankunas jars him out of bounds.
You know, the one thing about this that run there is Tennessee has run so many inside draw plays. It looks like the Auburn defense now is hugging the inside very tightly. And that time, Chuck Webb just bounced to the outside. Again, using those eyes to see the congestion inside, just bounced it outside for a nice little game.
Webb up the middle. Maybe a yard. The whole front led by Richard Shea for Auburn. Stops him. Near the first down. Dedicated fans at Tennessee.
Well, you know, this is amazing. 96,000 people in this kind of weather. And yet, when you think about the Southeastern Conference, I think of great stadiums. You hear LSU, Georgia. I mean, there's some tough places, Auburn. There's some real tough places to play in this conference.
Pat Dye, in conversation with Pat Dye, he says this is one of the more difficult ones in the conference. He thought Florida Field was the most treacherous. And surprisingly, he did not find LSU's Tiger Den to be right up there with it.
Well, he thinks what about Florida Field is the fans are right on top of you. Now, what he said about LSU, that although they're boisterous and loud, they're away from the playing field a little bit.
It's third down and about three raindrops. Inside of 4 minutes in the third quarter. Hinton should have it.
Again, right over this left guard that time, Tom Zielinski, who did a nice job. And when you get in a situation like that in short yardage, it's usually low man wins. Vaughn Reeves is limping around, but low man wins. And Zielinski, number 50, the left guard, really got low and cleared the way there for Hinton.
You speak of Zielinski, the left guard. He's from Rome, New York. Only a sophomore. His father's a high school coach. Flew into Knoxville today for this game after coaching last night. New York State high school football action. First and 10. Webb. Richard Shea shags him.
If Auburn's going to get back in this game, 3:20 left here in the third quarter, they're going to have to take away first down runs. They cannot allow Tennessee to get 4 and 5 yards on first down. They didn't there. In this kind of weather, a team with a lead is not going to throw the ball on first down, so you got to force them into being second and long.
Three receiver set for Tennessee. Delay give to Webb. Crawford had him. Crawford read that all the way. Harold Crawford, sophomore from Montrose, Alabama.
Crawford's a guy, Jim, that the coaching staff thinks he has a terrific future at Auburn. Terrific ability. They think he's going to be a big-time player. Great speed from sideline to sideline, but he's physical enough to hang in there, fight off some guards, take on fullbacks, and make plays.
You say he can be one of our best out of Auburn. Third down and 6. Ball resting at the 49 of Auburn. Hinton wanting to go quickly to Morgan. Maybe it was a fake. He has the first down before falling down at the 35.
I don't think that was a design play, Jim, but it was a nice play by Sterling Hinton. It was supposed to be a safe pass in this kind of weather, a screen pass to Anthony Morgan on the right side. Didn't like what he saw. He'll look to his right, trying to throw the screen. You see the lineman going that way, but he has the kind of foot speed to make something like this happen. Well, you have a play, that's frustrating for a defense. You have a play well defensed, and then you give up a play to a quarterback like Hinton.
Cobb back in the backfield, and he gets the pitch. Cobb for four. What a big day he's having. Craig Ogletree on the tackle. Reggie Cobb grew up here in Knoxville, said he did not grow up as a Tennessee fan. As a kid, he followed teams with great tailbacks. Teams like Georgia with Herschel Walker. And he also mentioned Auburn with Bo Jackson. I wonder if it's any coincidence he's wearing number 34. 15 carries, 164 yards, and the game's only touchdown. Second and four. Lamar Rogers on the tackle.
Well, interesting strategy Tennessee has here is, in this, again, this kind of weather, they're using an unbalanced line. They did on that play. Both their tackles, Antone Davis and Charles McCray, lined up on the left side, and that's the way they ran, right behind their two offensive tackles. One of them goes, Davis, 306, McCray, 283.
Hinton sends Harper to the left, Morgan to the right. Poles and Cobb in the backfield on third and three. Hinton danced around and lost yardage. May have taken his team out of field goal range. It's at the 36-yard line, a loss of seven. The line of scrimmage had been the 29, which equates to a 46-yard field goal. Now, from the 36, they're not going to go over 50.
That's a big defensive play. Good penetration up front by Rocker and Shea, and some guys inside really threw the rhythm of that option play off, and that's what an option play is, just a matter of rhythm.
Again, Andy Kelly, the quarterback, backup punter, is in to punt. Time expires, however, in the third quarter. No scoring in the third quarter. 12th-ranked Tennessee, 14-3 over 4th-ranked Auburn. CBS Sports returns after this message and a word from your local station. It is raining, and there is an upset in the making as we start the final quarter. Look at the advantage on the ground for Tennessee today. 278 yards to only 31. Two safeties for the Vols, who lead it 14-3 over 4th-ranked Auburn. This is 4th down now and 11. On the 36 of the Tigers. Andy Kelly, little pooch punt, what's called for here. He hits the knuckleball at the 9, and it goes into the end zone. Next Saturday, our CFA action continues. From Death Valley, Virginia and Clemson in the ACC. Virginia sure has rebounded after that opening fiasco against Notre Dame, scoring a big win at Penn State. Clemson was ranked 7th entering today's play, but saw its national championship hopes wash away today in the rain at Duke. Here, 4th-ranked Auburn with hopes of another SEC title or even a national championship shot, being challenged severely. Slaps pass for Wasden, incomplete.
Well, there you see the problem with playing in the rain. Ordinarily, that's the ball that Wasden catches with his hands. But because of all the rain and it's so wet, you have to get your body in front of the ball. It's going to go right through your hands. And 14-46 for this Auburn team. They need to score, make a two-point play, and then still get a field goal to tie the ball game.
They tied here in 87. Second down and 10. Slack throwing it away. Jason Julian on the coverage. Hayworth in the backfield, all over Slack.
And Jason Julian again did a very nice job of covering Wasden. And Julian has really done it all. He has played the run, he's knocked passes down, and then he's covered guys well all afternoon. Well, I've been very impressed with him. Really came here as a kicker.
really come on this year.
Only a sophomore from right here in Knoxville. Two sophomores in that secondary along with two juniors. Third and 10. Slack falls to the turf. Mark Moore in the area. Punting time for Auburn.
Mark Moore, not a great 40-yard time, but you don't measure him by his 40-yard time. He can move in a 10 or 12-yard area. The wrong measuring stick for Mark Moore.
A precarious area all day today for Auburn, backed up near the goal line. Hudson is the snapper. Again, this is the third snapper of the day. After two safeties. A low one this time. Dickinson gets it away. Favorable bounce. Ball comes right to the 50. 34-yard punt in all. And we send you back for an update to New York with Greg Gumbel. Greg?
Jim, thank you. The Miami Hurricanes have a 10-game winning streak on the line, but quarterback Craig Erickson has been sent to the hospital. He fractured a knuckle on his right finger, and he is out for the rest of the game. Redshirt freshman Gino Toretta has replaced him. 10-10 at halftime. Let's go back to the largest outdoor tub in Tennessee in Jim and Pat.
Tell you, tough day for teams in the top 10. Cobb, first down Tennessee to the 38, a gain of 11. John Wiley on the tackle.
You know, Reggie Cobb has done a nice job of running it. He'll be interviewed a lot after the game, but the offensive line of Tennessee has done a remarkable job. They've run all over the field with some pretty good success. But really, the right side behind Antone Davis and Eric Still is where they've really featured their running attack.
First and 10 with 13 minutes left in the game. Cobb again. Tackled by the whole front line of the Auburn defense.
We've been talking about how good this offensive line plays. Watch Antone Davis, the right tackle for Tennessee. Watch how he comes down and makes his play. And Still is to his left, just positions his big old 306-pound body and clears the way for the running back. That is what they've been doing all day. They've been positioning players, and then they can bury you as well. Really being impressed with not only Davis, who's 306 pounds and runs under a 5 flat 40.
It's all foul. Unsportsmanlike conduct over here.
Well, that's a big penalty. But also Charles McRae, the other tackle, number 70, did a marvelous job today.
Colorado leading at Washington. Many had wondered how the team would react to the loss this last week of their spiritual leader, quarterback Salinesi, passing away of cancer. Second down and 21 for the Volunteers from midfield. Cobb on the delay. Cobb still on his feet. Picks up 14 yards to the 36-yard line.
You know, Joe, I'm really surprised. Every time Tennessee gets into the three wideout or four wideout receiver, they've run the draw play. And every time it has been wide open. They stretch the defense. It takes four white jerseys out of the middle of the defense. And then they just run the little draw play. And because the inside linebackers are getting big bodies on them, there have been some huge holes inside in the draw. They must have run 15 draw plays today.
Reggie Cobb says, hey, everybody forgot about me starting this year. 19 carries, 195 yards, moving in on two. Flags fly, and the play is whistled dead.
Oh, man.
There's a marker on the play.
Tennessee came into this game, Jim, with very few penalties, only 45 yards the whole year in the first three games, a few turnovers, but they've had some mistakes. They've not run the two-minute drill well either.
Dead ball foul. Delay a game on the offense.
You know, the offensive line, we've talked so much about Tennessee, a lot of it is just push. Getting those big bodies, they get your hands out, that's legal now, you get your hands out, you get some leverage, you get underneath the shoulder pads, you see all the white jerseys going back. And that's why Reggie Cobb has had the kind of day he's had.
It's third down and 12, the 5-yard penalty. Left. Tennessee used up 11 and a half minutes of the clock in the third quarter. Still controlling the clock. Hinton trying to get away from Rocker. He steps out of bounds at the 43-yard line. Two consecutive possessions, Tennessee could have increased its lead. Got down near the 30-yard line, not able to do anything with it.
Some very, very costly mistakes. In that time, David Rocker did a great job, though, of forcing Sterling Hinton wide, way wide, so he didn't have time. The rhythm of the play was very much upset because of David Rocker's charge.
Illegal formation on the offense.
That is something they should decline, I would imagine.
It is on the offense, fourth down, it is declined.
Thank you very much for agreeing, Dick. Appreciate that.
It's going to be so difficult to come back in these conditions.
It really is, because your throwing game is all off rhythm. The receivers can't cut the way they would like to. It's hard holding on to the ball. Even the exchange between center and quarterback is difficult.
Andy Kelly to punt. Trying to bury Auburn inside of the 10. Fumbled. Watson dropped the football. He got it back.
Jim, with 11:43 remaining here, Auburn must score on this possession. But this is the third time that Wasden has had a hard time fielding it. It looks like that one, he went right through his hands. Earlier, he caught it a little bit too high underneath his throat.
He gets it back. Auburn needs some points in a hurry.
96,000 diehard Tennessee fans braving the elements here in Knoxville. Auburn trails by 11. Interesting to note that Auburn seldom sees a wet artificial turf field because they practice on the grass. And when it rains back in Auburn, they go inside to a dry artificial synthetic surface. So only four times, Jim and Pat, in the last seven or so, 9 years, have they had to deal with this kind of wet condition on artificial surface.
Doc, you're right. This is the fourth time, and they lost all three other occasions they played on wet turf.
Four receivers in on first down. Taylor in motion. Slack, passing. In and out of the hands of Alexander Wright. He should have had it.
Well, yeah. Those are the catches you have to make. But again, you saw four orange jerseys around, but that ball was well thrown by Reggie Slack. Wright lined up on the left side, crossing route again. It's a tiny little opening there, but Slack got him the ball. Remember, with 11:35 remaining in the game, they must score twice. Score a touchdown, two-point conversion, and the field goal. So every drive becomes important.
Second down and 10. Slack across the middle. Is that an interception? No, incomplete. Sean Walker almost had it after it filtered through the hands of James Joseph.
Well, I'm not so sure that wasn't an interception and then a fumble. Get pretty good protection here by the offensive line, trying to hit Joseph over the middle behind him. And I guess he didn't really have possession when his feet were down.
Third down and 10. Auburn's been backed up the whole second half. Slack looking long for Alexander Wright. He's got it. No one will get him. Touchdown, Auburn.
Going for 2 points, but I really thought Alexander Wright actually pushed off, quite honestly, Jim. That was a well-thrown ball by Reggie Slack in this kind of weather. But Alexander Wright, I thought he may have pushed off with his left hand off the receive, off the defensive back. Can't really see it from there, but this is the kind of play Alexander Wright has been doing all year. Open the season with a big play like this.
That's five touchdowns on the year that Slack and Wright have combined on, covering at least 68 yards.
Right here. You're going to see, no, right here. He's right there in the middle of the screen. Alexander Wright. And right there with his left hand, he pushed away from the defender there. But again, no one's going to catch him after he catches that ball. And now Auburn will go for the two-point play. And we were talking to Pat Dye yesterday about two-point plays. He said he'd go for one to win the game. This time he has to go for 2 points. And ordinarily what you do is you move the ball over, which they just did from the center of the field, and you try some sort of crossing route or a rollout with your quarterback. Try to give your team as many different options of getting the ball 3 yards in the end zone. It might be your quarterback running the ball in, and it might be two or three different receivers catching the ball.
11:15 left. Joseph offset to the right. Danley in the backfield. This to move within 3 points. Easily, Danley. And it's now 14-11, Tennessee.
Well, I say that is a gutsy call by Pat Dye. But he's got to back Stacy Danley, 220 pounds. They spread the defense wide with two wide receivers to the wide side. Ed King, number 67, just knocks Walker, number 45, out of the way. And that's a big two-point play. Auburn got away with one here. Alexander Wright in the white jersey there circled pushes off Preston Warren, number 21. You're going to watch his left arm as he pushes away from the defender. Right there. Clearly the push there and push Warren right out of the way. Nonetheless, the official did not call it. He got into the end zone, and then they had to, because they were down by 11, had to go for two points. And again, this was a nice call. They spread the defense out. As you take another look at the protection that Reggie Slack got, and he threw that ball a long way in some very difficult circumstances. Driving rainstorm and a guy in his face. Was a heck of a throw there by Slack. But then the two-point play. Down by 11, they had to spread the defense out. Got Danley the ball very deep. Picked up a big block by Ed King to get in the end zone.
Masterful job of spreading out the D on the two. And it's 14-11. Tennessee has had the football four possessions in the second half. Has had the punt all four times. But has had the clock, had the football for 8 more minutes on the clock. On the run back, Pickens to the 20. Again, Tennessee had some chances here in the second half and unable to advance it past the 30 of Auburn.
Football is very much a game of emotion, and right now all the emotion is on the Auburn team, particularly this defense.
Andy Kelly is the quarterback for the Volunteers on first and 10. Reggie Cobb for another 12, and he's over 200.
And what a nice block he got by his fullback, Roland Poles, Jim. Again, Cobb has done a terrific job, but watch Poles, number 42, who's going to block 47 Billingsley. Again, Billingsley ordinarily makes that play, but Poles cleared the way for Cobb to pick up the first.
First time since Bobby Humphrey in 1986 that someone has rushed for over 200 yards against this Auburn defense. First and 10, Cobb again. What a day he's having to the 47-yard line, a gain of 15.
Reggie Cobb told us yesterday that this is going to be a fourth quarter game. And he follows the right side, a Now, his offensive line is beautifully again, and watch the hole as it opens up. Again, Nick Ray does a nice job. The tight end Reeves does a nice job. And then he fights through a couple of tackles.
Cobb goes out. Webb comes in. First and 10. Fumble on the exchange. Kelly falls on it. Pull back a little quick.
You know, Jim, every quarterback is taught in weather like this, because generally the centers have a tough time getting the ball up because it's so wet, to stay in underneath the center just a little bit longer, particularly you're protecting a three-point lead.
Wow. Easily surpassing the 144 yards garnered against Kentucky. 1987, Webb, maybe a yard.
This is a very important down for the Tennessee offense. For trying to protect a three-point lead, it's third and about 13 yards. You're so concerned about putting the ball up in these kind of circumstances. What they've done so far is run the draw play. They spread people out and run the draw play very successfully in this situation before.
Handler lined up behind Kelly. Third and 11. Kelly, incomplete. Tenet for Von Reeves, and Eric Ramsey broke it up.
Or did Ramsey make a nice play? He thought he should have picked it off and perhaps he would have scored. A great job of just reading the eyes of Andy Kellen and then driving on the ball.
Kent Elmore comes in to punt. 8:59 left in the game. 14-11, 12th-ranked Tennessee leading over number 4 Auburn. Long kick. Wasden makes the grab at the 10. Swarmed under at the 13. Tracy Hayworth. Casey Rogers. Auburn struck quickly last time. They're within 3. At the conclusion of today's CBS Sports College football broadcast, we will select the Chevrolet Most Valuable Player of the Game from each team. Chevrolet donates a $1,000 scholarship to the General Scholarship Fund of each school. The American League East, it's over. Toronto comes back today from a 3-1 deficit to beat the Orioles and clinch it. Here, just listen to this enormous crowd. Volunteers cheering on the defense. Slacks pass to Taylor. Preston Warren wraps him up, but it's a first down. First down for Auburn. We take it downstairs to John Dockery.
Thank you, Jim. And one of the things you can do on the sidelines is to get a feel for what's going on with a player. Well, I watched Reggie Slack the last 5 minutes after he threw that touchdown. He was very cool, unemotional, calm. He went over to his offensive linemen, talked to them for a moment. Then he went to his one of the receivers and said a quiet word. And you remember yesterday when we talked to him, he said he liked it at the end of the game with the game on the line and him driving for the winning score.
Well, he's got it now, Doc. On first and 10, his pass is deflected. Hobby was over there along with Hardy.
And it was Hobby again. I think it was his second deflection by Hobby. Again, those are big plays. It doesn't look like much, a tip ball. But you never know over the course of a season how many plays like this are going to be the difference between winning a championship or not. Just a little tip ball. Hobby got both hands on that one.
Hobby again was not given an opportunity by Auburn. They did not recruit him, even though he grew up in Alabama. Having a big afternoon for the Volunteers. Second and 10, pass to Danley, run down by Hayworth.
That is a terrific play by Tracy Hayworth. So this guy is playing defensive end and makes the play out there. He is rushing the passer, number 88, and then gets out to put the stop on Danley on the screen pass. It was roughly rushing the passer there first, comes off the tackle's block, and then makes the play on Danley. Well, that is hustle. He knows what's on the line in the opening game of the SEC season.
It's third and seven for Auburn. 7:40 left in the game. Slacks pass high and intercepted. Shazon Bradley.
Probably should have caught. It was high and tipped, and Bradley doing a nice job of just staying back deep, playing the zone defense, and made a nice catch on the interception.
Cobb on the first down carry gets inside of the 40 to the 39-yard line. Tennessee with a chance to eat up more of the clock and also perhaps to add to its total, leading 14-11 over number 4 Auburn. Second and seven. Hinton, nice play action fake. Quentin Riggins, though, staying right with him for no gain. Check-in time to New York. We go back to Greg Gumbel with the update. Greg?
Jim, as you reported, the Baltimore Orioles storybook season is over. Ninth inning, Tom Henke gets Larry Sheets on strikes, and a three-run eighth inning rally carries the Toronto Blue Jays past the Orioles and into the American League Championship Series against the Oakland Athletics. Let's go back to Tennessee.
Thank you, Greg. Toronto and Oakland in the American League. Third down for Tennessee. Third and seven. Three receivers in the game. A little jump pass to Cobb. First down to the 22-yard line, a gain of 18.
Sterling Hinton has done lots of different things this year to help his team win. That time, the little jump pass. Again, three or four linemen down there to lead the way for Reggie Cobb. But he fought through a couple of guys himself. Charles McRae, number 70, again, through a key block for Cobb.
6:20 left in the game. Each team with two timeouts. First and 10. Webb, all kinds of room. First and goal. Stan Kunis and Barlow bring him down in the secondary.
Anytime you're running the ball as well as Tennessee is, when the defense knows you're going to run the football, the center and the two guards and the two tackles are doing a great job. Auburn knows that Tennessee's protecting the lead. They know they're going to run the football, but they can't stop this great offensive line charge.
Webb stays in on first and goal. Webb holds on to it. It's a touchdown for Tennessee. Left in the game. And Tennessee is up by two scores again. Burke connects on the extra point. Chuck Webb and Reggie Cobb.
Jim, this offensive line is making it look easy. Low man wins down here. 42 pull too, and Chuck Webb makes sure he is not going to fumble the football. An impressive drive, Jim. The offensive line did a great job of just coming after them. They threw the one little deep pass, and then they got the ball into the end zone.
$96,000 rocking in the rain.
staggering to me. And again, I think this is still a pretty good Auburn defense. It just tells you how well Tennessee has played offense today.
Squid kick goes past Wasden through the end zone. It's a touchback. I don't mean to belabor the point, but again, Auburn last year, in its SEC championship year for the second straight year, I might add, did not allow a team to rush for 100 yards. And today, in the SEC opener, the Vols are at 354 on the ground.
But there's still plenty of time. 10-point lead, 547. You have a guy like Reggie Slack, who's the all-SEC quarterback a year ago. You still have time. You can't waste any down, but you have time to come back.
Four receivers in for Slack. Tony Russell and Pedro Terry, the extra receivers on first and 10. Across the middle, it's set up for Danley. Danley has first down yardage at the 34. A gain of 14. You've just joined us. The scoring began with a safety. Snap over the punter's head. Then Reggie Cobb for Tennessee, 79 yards. Another safety, 11-0. Lyle got on the board for Auburn. Burke countered with a field goal for Tennessee. Right here in this quarter, 83-yard touchdown reception. And just moments ago, it was Webb from 8 yards, touchdown for Tennessee. Taylor to the 39-yard line. Hammered by Preston Warren and Darrell Hardy.
And they're on the line, and this is where Reggie Slack was concerned about the crowd noise. You see him giving hand signals to call the routes. He'll put numbers up in the hand, and that's the routes the receivers run.
Staying with the four-receiver set. Taylor again. First down at midfield for Auburn. Sean Walker on the tackle. Auburn scurries to the line of scrimmage. Must put it in the end zone, Pat. Two scores down. 10-point lead for Tennessee.
5 minutes, still plenty of time to get the ball. Trying to get the ball to receiver on the move.
Staying across the middle. Danley hammered by Walker after the reception.
If you watch Reggie Slack's hands here, again, he will signal the routes right there. The two means a certain route that they have for his wide receivers.
Spreading out the field, staying across the middle. Taylor, another first down for the Tigers.
That takes some courage by Greg Taylor. He has caught 3 balls over the middle now, and each time has taken a shot.
Taylor and Russell go out. Wasden and Overton come in as Auburn stays with four receivers. From the 37-yard line of the Volunteers. All kinds of time. Slack has running room. Galore out of bounds at the 20-yard line. Gain of 17.
Boy, and a nice block by his right tackle, Rob Selby, really allowed Slack to get outside the defensive coverage and make the play. You haven't seen Reggie Slack. He's a very patient guy. You don't see him scramble much because he's so heads up in the pocket, yet he's got very good foot speed.
This drive started at Auburn's 20. They've moved it to the Tennessee 20 very quickly. 4:07 remaining. Slack. Again, it's Hobby batting it down.
Four times, Marion Hobby has knocked the ball down, tipped the ball. Again, for all anybody knows, this may have been a touchdown. But again, he gets the paws up. One of those subtle little things, Selby, he drives Selby, number 78, back too close to Reggie Slack. And then he gets up, he's 6'4", he gets those big hands up to knock the ball down.
That was Slack's first incompletion on this drive. He's 5 for 6. Second and 10. Setting up a screen to Joseph. Clock out in front by King. But the tackle at the 17 by Sean Walker. Fireworks going off in the background here. Some celebration. Maybe a little too early here in Knoxville. 3:40 left.
injured defensive player for Tennessee down now.
It's Mark Moore.
Yeah. Well, he has played well inside today. Their best inside tackle.
It's a timeout on the field. Auburn is driving and trailing by 10. It's followed by Tour of Duty and Saturday Night with Connie Chung, featuring the story of a 14-year-old who ran a highly lucrative but very illegal business. And the first interview with Jane Fonda since her breakup with Tom Hayden. That's tonight on Saturday Night with Connie Chung.
No relation, by the way, to me. I just want to let you guys know that. This is a very, very important play for Auburn. They have hopes of winning a national championship. It comes down to this play.
Third and 8. Slack on the delay to Danley. Tennessee read it all the way. Jeff Tullis had just entered the game, a freshman from Missouri, and he drops him for a 6-yard loss.
Everybody's going to question Pat Dye with that call. I don't think it was a bad call. Everybody's expecting pass. You spread the defense out, and then you try to run the draw play.
Well, they'll go for the field goal in this possession. Should they score, they'll have to get the touchdown on the next one. 41 yards from the middle of the field. Dickinson on the hole. Must convert. It snuck in there. Lower left-hand corner. And it's a 7-point lead.
And with 2:45, Jimmy, you have to think whether he's going to go for the onside kick. You got to expect him to do that.
He has 2 timeouts left. That ball went shooting through there like a knuckleball.
Yeah. Tomorrow's
a doubleheader day for us here on CBS. Early, you'll get one of these games. You'll have to check your local listings. Washington against the Saints, Tampa Bay and Minnesota, Falcons and Green Bay. Late, the big matchup from Candlestick, the Rams and Niners, or the Giants and Cowboys. It all gets started 12:30 Eastern Time with the NFL Today.
As a former Ram, that is the biggest rivalry the Rams have, Rams and 49ers. But Jim, going back to the draw play that Pat Dye called, I know he'll be second-guessed tomorrow on that call. Remember how much success Tennessee has had running the draw. I think it's a good call in that situation. You have a big back, but what Auburn really doesn't do a lot of is audible. And when Reggie Slack saw some inside linebackers there, it probably would have been the time to audible to an outside play.
Tennessee moves nine men up close at the 45-yard line. Pickens.
This is your hands team on defense. All the guys in orange jerseys there are guys who are used to handling the ball. They're good hands people.
Von Wild to kick for Auburn. 2:45 left. The Tigers have 2 timeouts remaining. Which side are they going? Bounces high in the air. Auburn recovers. Recovered by Corey Barlow. That was a picture book onside kick.
That was a perfect kick because it took 2 bounces. On AstroTurf 2, you're going to get a high bounce off that second bounce. And Wild is nice at 1, and then the second bounce right there goes high. And then Barlow did a great job, number 12, of getting high above the Tennessee players. Really surprised the Tennessee guys weren't going forward on that, Jim.
From right at midfield. Auburn with 4 receivers. Slack is buried by Fletcher. 3rd sack of the day. And a loss of 8.
Reggie Slack called the timeout. This is the second shot he gets in the backside, and protection always starts in the backside. You can never let this happen to your quarterback. Gets the strong safety, Fletcher, number 36. Somebody, a back or a guard, has got to step out and pick him up.
Mark Fletcher with the big play. Let's find out about some more big plays. It's update time. Let's take it back to New York with Greg Gumbel.
All right, Jim, by day's end, the day's best performance may belong to Houston quarterback Andre Ware. 11 of 16, 203 yards, 3 touchdowns, all in the first quarter. They've just started the second quarter in Houston, and Houston leads it big, 27-0. In Manhattan, Kansas, K-State ends the longest losing streak in the nation at 16 with a win over North Texas. Notre Dame wins number 16 in a row. They will play Stanford next week. Miami on top of Michigan State, 20-10. That's a third quarter score. The Hurricanes looking for number 4 in a row. Oregon State falls to Nebraska in the first meeting of those two schools in 30 years. And Colorado leads Washington, Eric Bieniemy, with 2 touchdown runs. Let's go back to Tennessee.
Greg, I just want you to know you have a happy alumnus of Houston right here in Jim Nance, believe me.
Say, they can put some points on the board, can't they?
What is he averaging? 450 yards a game passing.
Yes. Last week against Arizona State, over 700 yards total offense for Houston. Second down and 18 for Auburn. Slack in the pocket, unloading on the sidelines and over the head. Tony Russell.
Now third and 19. If you're Johnny Majors, you want to keep everything in front of you. If you're Pat Dye, you have to figure two downs to get 19 yards. You don't have to get it all in once. And that's Pat Sullivan, who's a little upset. I don't think he's happy, perhaps, that the play is called, but they have two downs to get the 19 yards.
Third and 19. Across the middle, Slack to right. First down, Auburn, 37-yard line of Tennessee. Picked on Preston Warren with that pass play of 22 yards.
Reggie Slack said yesterday, I want to be a national championship quarterback on a national championship team. They think they have a chance this year, and they've got 2:17 to go down and try to do it. Got to get the ball in the end zone.
As you mentioned, this is the kind of situation he said, I want to be in. He got his wish. First and 10, Tennessee blitzing. Pass is caught. Jason Julian lowers the boom. Alexander Wright. 1:50 remaining. Clock is running.
Auburn with one timeout remaining as well. So there's still time to get the ball into the end zone. But Reggie Slack can't take a sack. He can't have a turnover. They have to protect his backside. They haven't done it too well today.
Second down. Here comes Fletcher. Pass incomplete. And this, again, there is no in-the-grasp rule in college football.
And that may be the biggest play of the season for Auburn. Reggie Slack just did a great job. And we just said they have to protect his backside. The first thing in protection when you start during the year, if Fletcher's chasing him from the backside, is you have to protect the quarterback's blind side. The second time Mark Fletcher has come in from that side untouched.
Third and 5 from the 30. Pass batted down for the 5th time by Marion Hobby. Maybe this is his favorite hobby, batting down passes.
I've never seen a guy bat down as many passes in one game as Marion Hobby has today. His 5th tip of balls today.
And it's 4th down for the Auburn Tigers. Only one timeout left. Slack's pass incomplete. Intended for Alexander Wright. Some big games in its day. This one will be very high on the list. The Volunteers are back, having won 8 in a row and a minute and 19 seconds from their 9th consecutive victory.
They
give that man some credit, too. Johnny Majors fought through some tough times last year when he was 0-6. People calling for his head. He hung in there, played a lot of young people. Knew that he was going to have a pretty good football team this year. And Pat Dye was uncertain how good his defensive team was going to be.
Hinton, down on one knee. Auburn still has a timeout.
Does not get a whole lot easier for that man, Johnny Majors. Has to play Georgia next week.
Then at Alabama. And LSU. Sickles for the last time out. The fans are already coming out onto the field. Goal posts are coming down tonight in Knoxville, Tennessee.
Yeah, but with 7 seconds remaining, they're still going to have to get this snap off. More people get hurt like this, and these goalposts come down.
Football team trying to help out to clear the fans.
What do you do when you get an upright? You take that home, the whole upright?
Put in your dormitory.
I've always wondered about that.
You mean you didn't have one in yours?
No, how do you get that out of the stadium without people noticing?
Across with 7 seconds left. I guess he's going to call it a night.
Well, I'm surprised there. Maybe you hope for a fumble on fourth down. You force them to snap the ball. Remember the New York Giants a couple years ago? The situation that happened to them with Darkowitz. Surprised he didn't make him snap the ball.
Let's go down to John Dockery.
Coach, congratulations. What does this mean to your program?
Well, I think we have a good program. We're excited about winning the ball game, but we've got a lot of trouble with that. We're going to be excited about this today and tonight, and we don't have much luxury to enjoy it very long. We'll be looking forward to getting ready for Georgia tomorrow, but it's a terrific day. We've had a lot of great days before, and we hope we have some more good ones.
In your wildest dreams, did you think you could run on an Auburn defense like this?
Well, we hope that we could run, not like this, but we hope that we could run better than we have in the past. We feel like our running game's come along, and it did a terrific job today. I don't know that we've ever had a more outstanding running game against tough people than we did today, and we had to have it when it counted.
Thank you very much, Coach. Congratulations. Back to you, Jim Nance.
All right, Doc. 12th-ranked Tennessee, now 4-0 on the year. Upending 4th-ranked Auburn by the score of 21-14. We'll be back in just a moment.